Good afternoon. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Teresa Ladrigan-Welpley, and I serve as the director of the Bannon Institutes in the Ignatian Center for Jesuit Education here at Santa Clara. The work of the Ignatian Center, as many of you know, is to advance Santa Clara's distinctively Jesuit Catholic tradition of education by promoting the integration of faith, justice, and the intellectual life on our campus and in the larger community. One of the ways that we seek to actualize this integrating vision is through occasions such as today, when we gather together to reflect on pressing moral and spiritual issues facing our world, and to consider our individual and collective response. Pope Francis, in his recent encyclical, Laudato Si, on the care of our common home, urges global action and reflection on the climate crisis, linking the cry of the earth to the cry of the poor. Today, the Bannon Institute is honored to host Dr. Carolyn Woo, President and CEO of Catholic Relief Services, who will offer this afternoon's lecture entitled, I Am Climate Change. I Am the Cause. I Am the Solution. Father Bill Rewalk of the Society of Jesus, Chancellor of Santa Clara University, will offer Dr. Wu's formal introduction. Please join me in welcoming Father Rewalk.
Thank you, Teresa. Got the wrong glasses here. Pope Francis, in his encyclical on the environment, is calling for vision, for intelligence, and for action. No one is better suited to speak to us about the environment than Dr. Carolyn Woo, who has the intelligence and the vision, and in her work, her board service, and her writing, has acted wholeheartedly on behalf of our beleaguered planet. As president and CEO of Catholic Relief Services, she was featured in the June issue of Foreign Policy as one of the 500 most powerful people on the planet, and one of only 33 in the category of a force for good. Her monthly column in the Catholic News Service took a first place in the 2013 Catholic Press Association Awards. Actually, her previous experience has been mainly academic. She was born and raised in Hong Kong, immigrated to the United States to attend Purdue University, where she received bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degrees, and joined the faculty. She was the first female dean to chair the accreditation body for business schools. But her work soon extended far beyond academia. She works with the Child Abuse Review Board, is involved in migration, immigration, and refugee services, and sits on the International Policy Committee of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops. Dr. Wu was one of the five presenters in Rome at the release of Pope Francis' encyclical on the environment just this past June. Her faith journey and her work with Catholic refugee services are recounted in her book, Working for a Better World. We all hope for a better world. And Dr. Carolyn Woo can help us both to envision it and to work for it. Help me to welcome Dr. Carolyn Woo.
Thank you so much for having me here. I love coming to the University of Santa Clara. It's such a beautiful campus. I mean, every time I walk through, I just thought, oh boy, what a life here. So I just want to say thank you very much. And it is such a well-run university. My former colleague, Dennis Jacobs, is now the provost here, and he's such a gem. And you're very fortunate to have Dr. Jacobs. I also feel it's very special. I have two very longtime friend. So here today I have Audrey Riker and her daughter, Susie. We have not seen each other for 35 years. And yesterday I received an email that they sent through the CRS website that they would be here. And I cannot tell you, my heart just swells that you are here. So they're right there. Please give them a big hand. I was sitting there, and I feel like one of the first thing I need to do also is to offer an apology to, I think, St. Ignatius. I feel very badly that our screen covered up St. Ignatius, which is probably the most important symbol here. So my apologies to St. Ignatius. And St. Clair, I can't tell who is behind, but I feel almost sort of somewhat presumptuous to cover them up so that we could do a presentation. But please, because they are the reasons we are here, really. And I want to talk a little bit about being one of the 500 most important people on the planet. I think that's really, really cool. Yeah, don't you think? Except I don't think it's really about me. I see another old friend in the audience. Ed, how are you, Ed? Good to see you. So coming back to being one of the 500 people, I joined CRS in 2012, and I received this award at 2013. I think it's really cool to be so recognized, except it's not for any work that I did. I just happened to be at CRS at the right time. But I want to highlight that because I think that that recognition is really the recognition of the work of the U.S. Catholic Church. For 70 plus years, Catholic Relief Services have been out there since World War II to bring refugees first out of Eastern Europe during World War II. And today we're still bringing refugees out of someplace, and actually Eastern Europe too. You know, in addition to emergency and refugee work, we do other work, major development work. Catholic Relief Services actually belong to the U.S. Catholics. It was started by the Bishops' Conference. It's the official agency of the U.S. Catholic Church. It's like the Red Cross of the U.S. Catholic Church. In a substantive way, it's also funded by the U.S. Catholics. It's out in the world today in over 100 countries in the most difficult of places. We serve the poorest of the poor. Many people we serve, they make less than $1.25 a day. There are about a billion people who live on $1.25 a day, and we actually oftentimes work with people who don't have any income, period. We're in places like the Ebola countries in West Africa. We are in Gaza, for example. We are in the South Sudan in Central Africa region. We're in Nepal. We are in really very difficult places. And also, so I think that that recognition goes to the work of the U.S. Catholic Church, and also not just the service provided, but the voice that we brought back to the United States. The sufferings that we saw, the conflict that we saw, what we tell Congress, for example, we do a lot of congressional testimonies, we do a lot of advocacy to let people know what is really going on in the world, the degree of suffering, and so on. So I want to share this because I think that it is a recognition that goes to all of us, over and many people, our colleagues and so on, who have now since passed through. But, you know, it's the a reminder of the importance of service and a voice, of an agency that go out to serve in the name of God, the love of God to everyone. And we serve on the basis of need and not on the basis of creed. We are often in countries where Catholics are not even 1% of that particular country. Today we serve about 100 million people in the name of the church. So I just want to draw that to your attention. So as I go into this talk, the first thing I want to do is really show a little video. It's about 5 minutes relating to Laudato Si. I'm going to bring my colleague Ken to come up, and we're going to all pray for a quick minute for the internet gods, including St. Clara, to make sure that our live streaming from the internet works. Thank you. All right.
Go Come è stato annunciato, giovedì prossimo sarà pubblicata una lettera enciclica sulla cura del creato. Invito ad accompagnare questo avvenimento con una rinnovata attenzione alle situazioni di degrado ambientale, ma anche di recupero nei propri territori. Questa enciclica è rivolta a tutti. Preghiamo perché tutti possano ricevere il suo messaggio e crescere nella responsabilità verso la casa comune che Dio ci ha affidato a tutti.
Laudate si, o mi Signore, laudate si, o mi Signore, laudate si, o mi Signore, laudate si, o mi Signore. Laudato Si comes from the music of the heart, music of the human heart. It comes from the music of nature singing praise to God. It comes from an effort, an attempt to give a new hope to the world, a new sign that we are all related, we are all responsible one for the other. Laudato Si comes from the voice in the heart of God. It's God's song that sings through creation. It's God's song that sings through each of us. Laudato Si is an expression of responsibility. It tells us that I no longer can live my life for myself. My life is a mission, as Pope Francis tells us. My life is to give glory to God by respecting and caring and promoting a sense of being in this together, that life is one, and that we're all members. Each of us bring a special contribution. So it's not just a flowery song about how we should live with nature. It's challenging us to revise our entire way of living our lives, how we internalize the values of the gospel of our Christian lives, and what challenges this means for us. If someone is starving somewhere in the world, we are responsible. If someone doesn't have enough food to eat, then we need to reduce and review the way that we approach food, the way we approach our use of goods, the way we accumulate things, the way we expend and discard things. We need to be challenged to review, to conduct a conversion of our own lives. Nature is barking. Nature is chasing after us, telling us we've got to wake up. It's disturbing us. But it's not disturbing us in order to threaten our lives. It's telling us we are already a threat to ourselves. We're a threat to the world. And nature is trying to tell us, step back from the brink before it's too late. What happens in exploitation without limitation is not only is nature stripped of its dignity, which God gave it, and we cannot deny that, but we are progressively stripped of our own dignity. Because each time that we fail to show dignity toward other human beings and toward nature, we lose our own dignity. We lose our own recognition of our special character, if you will, that God has given to us as human beings, that we are called to be this mission, to be this witness in a particular way. Laudate si, o mi Signore, 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 laudate si.
So, okay, let's tame the technology so that I could come back to you. By the way, the person, the singer, actually is Father Michael Perry. I'm in a Jesuit institution, so I'm not going to recruit for the Franciscans. But for some of you who are, you know, for example, thinking of vocation, you know, that's a cool guy. He has spiked hair, right? I don't know whether you notice. All right.
and he rides a motorcycle. And when he was young, he grew up in Indianapolis. He was in a folk group. He had a guitar. He loved to sing. He wanted to become a lawyer. But somewhere along the road, he became a priest with spiked hair. He worked with CRS at one point, and he is now the head of the Global Franciscans, the OFM branch. But anyway, that's Father Michael Perry. I want to come back. I want to make 10 points. I have this thing that I dread speakers who go on and on and on. They lose me. So I try to be disciplined most of the time. And I just want to make 10 points for this. I'm not going to review the science of climate change because I think that there's a lot of occasions to do that. And I'm not a scientist, actually. The reason we call this I am climate change, I am the cause, I am the solution, is because that is the name of a program we are rolling out in universities. We have a climate program that has the resources that allow people to learn more, to understand the consequences, to see some of those played out, because in the 100 countries that we work in, oftentimes we deal with the aftermath of very severe storms, frequent storms, and also actually the issue of drought in agricultural communities, and also people who have lost their livelihood because of rise in sea level and so on. So we see the aftermath of it. So we bring to college campuses a set of resources, and we will every 2 weeks starting in January release new resources so that we could keep this topic fresh and in front of everybody's mind. And that's why we called this talk, I Am Climate Change. My 10 points. The first thing, I just want to begin with a little, very short anecdote. Cardinal Tagle from the Philippines is a wonderful, wonderful a cardinal, just very compassionate, very knowledgeable, smart, but first of all, very pastoral. When he encountered this encyclical, he said, sometimes we'd have to think about, what do we have to praise? And, you know, and he said his most difficult encounter in his life as a priest was when he had to bury two young girls who died because they ate chicken that was retrieved by their father from the garbage bin. So he asked the question, he said, praise be to what and for what? In a world where food becomes waste and then become somebody else's food. Right? That's a very graphic illustration. In some ways, this is not within the Laudato Si, but actually, I think in many ways, it captured the spirit also of what the Pope is trying to teach us. In this example of people who are so poor, and also the whole idea of food waste, which then is retrieved, but unfortunately, it has already spoiled. The second thing, of course, this particular term, Laudato Si, came from the canticle of St. Francis, where St. Francis reminded us that the earth is actually our common home and that our bodies are made of her elements. And so, as Father Perry said, it's a song from the heart. It's about praise be to God's creation. That's where the praise is. Praise be to God's creation. Another point, though, that we don't emphasize a lot, except in some of the other statements, is that it also asks, how do we praise God? You know, that praise is not just to God for what God has given us. But it also posed a question, which is, for what God has given us, how do we praise God? And in fact, in that video, you know, our lives is supposed to give glory to God. So that praise is not just a passive thank you to God, but it's also calling for a very active response, which is, how do we praise God? I want to liken, actually, just because, you know, it's a pretty dense document, Laudato Si. I don't want a show of hands in terms of how many has read it, because I don't really want to know. But it's a pretty dense, though readable document, I think. I like to actually use the analogy you know, a song from the country music genre. How many of you are country music fans? Just raise your hands. Okay. This is not a big country music group, I could see. Neither am I, and I cannot sing, so I'm going to give you some of the lyrics I wrote, which I think kind of capture Laudato Si. And it goes like this. I gave you my love and you rejected it. I gave you my heart and you gave it to somebody else. I gave you my best creation and you didn't cherish it. I saw the best in you, but you forgot who you are. Right? I mean, that's country music, rejection and dejection and sort of having given so much and being completely left behind. So that is sort of the message that Pope Francis is giving to, you know, of God's love for us and how we take it for granted. God gave us our heart and we somehow worship something else. He gave us his best creation and we didn't take care of it. He saw the best in us and somehow we settled for some lower version of ourselves. That's the country music. And it's based on the fact, of course, that we haven't treated the earth very well. You see some of the pictures in California. I actually don't have to paint the picture for you. I think this is a state which is very, very clear-minded about some of these issues. The Pope actually used a lot of science in writing the Laudato Si. The Vatican actually convened scientists for several years, actually over decades. And the Pontifical Academy of Sciences really invited the best of scientists for several decades on this issue. In fact, the first statement on the climate actually comes in the U.S. comes from the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops in 1981, over 35 years ago. All right. So this is a document which is not without science. In fact, the Pope said science is the best tool for us to hear the cry of the earth. It's just that he didn't want to make this into a scientific working paper. But a lot of his observation is based on science. And in fact, when Laudato Si first came out, I remember I was there. It's an amazing experience. There were over 400 journalists from around the world. Immediately as it went out, you know, criticism, comments, and so on were coming back in real time. One of the criticisms that came from some of the American politicians was that, what does the Pope know about science? Well, they retracted that statement, finding out that he was actually a chemistry major. And his first job was actually a chemist in a lab. So they retracted that. But that third point really is about this song and the genre of dejection and rejection in the country music sort of style. It's based on a lot of science in terms of the observation of why, of how we have not treated the world well and the creation well. But it is just not so much a scientific document as it is a document actually about relationships. In fact, this is what point I am now, just to be honest, this is my fourth point. So as a love song, and I think we have to think and approach Laudato Si as a love song. As a love song, I think there are three elements that follow from it. One is about relationships, right? I mean, that's what love is a relational thing. The second one is about responsibility. And then the third one is about response. And I'm going to characterize the encyclical using just this three frame, these three dimensions: relationships, responsibilities, and response. The fifth point is about relationship. Very early on in the document, it says, the Pope reminded us, all life on this planet is connected. We are bounded together. We are all sort of in the same universe, in the same ecosystem. We are all joined, we with each other and we with creation. And in fact, he said, human life is based on three foundational relationships: our relationship with God, our relationship with each other, and our relationship to creation. And that all of these relationships and all life on the planet abounded together. And that's why he said, they're not two different crises. The cry of the poor and the cry of the earth comes from the same crisis, the same, come from the same causes. It's not like they're two different things. They're two manifestations of the same problems. And the problem he identified is the way we live. It's the way we relate to each other. It's the way we relate to God. It's the way we relate to creation. So the most important thing, I mean, he has a lot of teaching in this, but the most important thing he said, I think, is we are a society which is so focused on ourselves to the point where in some cases we raise selfishness and self-centeredness almost to a virtue. The self-centeredness and selfishness almost to a virtue. Wow. Wow. Right? And along with that, one manifestation of that self-centeredness and how it becomes a virtue is the way we put profits and our own incomes and so on above everything else. Right? That's where it becomes a virtue, is to the extent that self-centeredness and selfishness lead us to be able to really become very rich, whether it's as an individual or as an organization. We raise that profit, and we raise that profit, and in society there is certain worshiping of wealth, right? And therefore it becomes a virtue. And we raise profits above people. That's the Pope's biggest point. It's not that he doesn't believe in business. You know, a lot of people said, is he anti-business? He's not so much anti-business as he is anti a lot of the consequences of sort of like the type of personal values and the conduct of business which create problems. He particularly warns us, when we put profit above people, everything goes awry. We lead to economic development, economic growth, which sometimes is unsustainable. We use up resources which cannot keep up with that type of growth. That growth doesn't always benefit everyone. In fact, we have seen in the countries which have increased in wealth, the poor people actually get left behind. And in fact, in the United States now, we have the highest gap in terms of the riches and the people at the bottom, the largest income gap we have ever seen. So economic growth doesn't always benefit everyone. He reminded us, for example, that economic growth sometimes comes from inducing people to consume, to keep on buying things, and overpurchase and overconsumption of things lead to the ways that we are creating, right? And think about all of our iPhones, our computers, everything plastic and so on. Where do all of these things go? Right? So he reminds us about that. And putting profits above everything else also lead us to misvalue, undervalue things that don't make profits for us. So to the extent that air doesn't make profit for us, we don't care. I was with the ministers of some island state, and there are these islands where the rise in the sea level really completely wipes them out. And he was talking about this 2-degree centigrade solution, which is sort of the U.S. and a global commitment to some way to say perhaps we could allow for a growth of 2 degrees centigrade within the next 50 to 100 years. By the way, they say if it's not watched, the temperature of the world can go up by 4 degrees centigrade. So our global solution is let's settle for 2 degrees centigrade because we think we could manage the crisis at that level. And he said, Carolyn, I can't accept that because all the corals in the water would have died. And my people live on fishing, and fishes depend on corals. We just have wiped out our livelihoods at that rise. So it may be workable for most of the world, and workable is, you know, debatable, but he said it definitely doesn't work for us. But for the rest of us, we don't know what corals, what is the value of corals. And so to the extent that it doesn't have a profit value, we don't know what the value is, we become dismissive. We don't want to destroy it, but somewhere along the line, if it is destroyed, it sort of like hurts nobody, except that there's somebody who just doesn't have a voice. And so the Pope reminded us that we then sort of, in a very arrogant way, put a value on species which have been lost. The whole biodiversity issue is lost because, you know, we don't, you know, it doesn't serve us, and therefore, you know, it doesn't have much value. The Pope reminded us that these things are made by God. It is, nothing is created without a purpose. Everything has a value, and it is a bit arrogant for human beings to attach that value. By the way, a lot of times, and I, that helped me, an analogy that helped me is I have no idea, you know, like the temperature rising by 2 degrees centigrade. Like, it's hard to sort of like feel what that means, except the very top scientist on climate is this German, and he runs the Potsdam Institute in Germany. And he said, Carolyn, you have to think about this. The Earth is a very sort of fine-tuned ecological system. It's like your body. It's like your body, instead of operating at 98.6 as the average temperature, it operates at 100.6. And if we don't watch it, it would have to operate at 101.6 or 102.6. He said that's what it means in terms of stress. If you can understand your own body accepting, you know, operating at a much higher degree of temperature, which, you know, we don't function well, and actually we could die if we have to operate at over 100 degrees consistently over a long period of time. So he gave that particular analogy. But the bottom line really is that it's about relationships of how we live relative to our statement about who God is in our life, where our neighbors are, and also where creation is. The Pope, a lot of times, Pope Francis also talk about the throwaway culture. And he sees, you know, we are a throwaway culture. And he also reminded us, not only is it bad for the environment, a throwaway culture will lead us to throw away people. Right? When we are dismissive, we're dismissive in many ways across the board. And that's why you see Pope Francis, he reaches out to the prisoners. He reaches out to the throwaway people of our society. He always calls for the love for the elderly, because he also recognizes they often get left behind. He is particularly compassionate to the disabled children. He speaks for the migrants, because migrants have absolutely no voice, because they have no citizenship by definition. They don't belong to any country. The country they belong to, they have left. They're in countries that don't claim them. He also stands for the mentally ill. So Pope Francis, a lot of times, actually recover from society the notion of sort of people who are just don't have worth. And of course, the poorest of people, they also are not visible in our society. But it's the whole idea that he says, if you are in a throwaway culture, you will throw away people. So that's the fifth point I want to make about the throwaway, the relationship issue. The next one is actually pretty simple, pretty short. He reminds us of our responsibility. And that is, he opened the encyclical with the question, what type of world do you want to create? Not just for yourselves, but for the children who are already here. What do you want to make of your life's purpose, of your work's purpose? And he reminded us from Genesis, God gave us the earth to till and to keep. To till, we work it, we plant it, we harvest from it, we do all sorts of things, because the earth is supposed to sustain us and to nourish us. But what about the keeping part? We just keep tilling and we are not keeping. We are not taking care. So he asks this question of sort of like this gift which is given to us. We are the stewards of these gifts. We are not the owners, and we are definitely not the creators of these gifts. What is our responsibility in terms of proper stewardship for these gifts? So that's a whole issue of responsibility, right? The third part of it is about response, right? Relationship, responsibility, and response. What will we do? What will we do? In fact, it's the other part of praise be. It's not just praise be to God for your creation, but how will we use our life to give praise? So what will we do? What will we do? What is our agency in this? And by the way, he also introduces a concept called ecological conversion. And what conversion really is about learning, seeing, knowing, consciousness. Consciousness. The second point is, if you're conscious, are you committed? And then the third point is, will you act on your commitment? It's sort of the whole area of, there's no problem. Well, there is. It's not my problem. Well, it is. Well, there's not anything I can do about it. Well, unfortunately, there is something we can do about it. So he calls for this whole ecological conversion, which is you have to learn and you have to know and you have to open your eyes. And I think that's what encyclical is actually doing. He's forcing a lot of people who don't want to know. He puts it on the table. We cannot walk away from it. And if we do, that's a very explicit decision to walk away from it. And so it is a problem. It is our problem. And it is a problem that we can do something about. That's the point. And so, of course, he actually gave some examples of what we can do. But I just want to say, this is my seventh point, I think. One is, as a consumer, right? One is, as a consumer, we all buy things. There's virtuous consumption, and I think there's irresponsible consumption. You know, we are a shopping culture. There's no other way to state it. I mean, just see the malls what we have. And I think I'm one of those. I think I love to go shopping to some degree, not like real shoppers. But compared to the people we serve, those who don't have electricity, those whose house is really a mud hut, and I've seen many of those where the roof is actually made of grass, where there's very little food, and they cook all of their food actually outside using wood, which is collected from the hills and so on. You come to realize how much we have things that we don't really, really need. But more than just overconsumption, I want to give an example because it's powerful to me. And that is, I love flower arranging. I just love it. It's a way that I relax. And I don't know whether you remember, some of you may be old enough, that in the 70s or 80s, flowers were not cheap. Like, you have to pay $3.50 for a long stem rose. Does anybody remember those days when it's about $3.50 for a long stem rose? But nowadays, you can go to a big box retailer and you could buy a bundle of 20 long stem roses for $15. You could buy it in white, you could buy it in red, you could buy it in yellow. And now, you know, so it's less than $1 a rose. And $1 now is much less in value than, you know, 30 years ago. In another word, long stem roses now are very inexpensive. And I love it because then you could buy bundles of it and do whatever you want with it. And you scatter the house with bouquets of red roses or white roses or whatever it is. Until I went to Ethiopia and I visited a greenhouse. And the greenhouse is about this wide, maybe a little bit wider. And it's just long. It just keeps on going and going and going and going. It belongs to a conglomerate out of Europe. And these flowers are then harvested and sent to actually European market rather than the U.S. market. But within this greenhouse, by the way, it's completely enclosed, but it's enclosed by plastic. And it's really hot. I mean, the Ethiopian temperature can get over 100 degrees. So you, and inside these enclosures, it's just much hotter. I mean, the sun is beating on it. The other problems, there's several problems with it, is that the use of chemicals as fertilizers and pesticides create fumes in these enclosures. And they expose people to cancers, carcinogens. And so the people who work there have a higher rate of cancer because of very poor ventilation. And they're in there for long period of times and then inhale the fumes. Another problem it creates is that it draws down the water table of the farming community nearby. It just sucks up the water. And so if you were a small little farmer, you have no choice, but your wife and your daughters will go to work in these greenhouses because you can't farm well. All right. So I took a look at that and I thought, ooh, now I know. I mean, I just feel crazy for these cheap roses because all of a sudden it's clear why they are cheap. They're cheap because a lot of the cost associated with that is not imputed into the price of those flowers. And these Ethiopian workers, they don't have enough power to really argue. Now, in a neighboring country, which is Kenya, which is further along and more sophisticated in some ways, oh, please don't tape that, but further along, it actually has stiffer regulations with respect to the number of breaks that people need to have and also the concentration of these chemicals in the air, in the environment. You could have rules, you could have labor rules about these things. And also it requires these companies to return water, recycle water, to put it back into reuse and so on so that it doesn't draw so much water. So I just want to give that example because we consume so much and we like cheap products. All right. Another thing I remember is when I was a child, shrimp was very expensive. I don't know when anybody else remembered, and you have shrimp as a treat and you may have it at best once a week. But now shrimp is not expensive, right? Relatively speaking. And we eat a lot of shrimp and so on. But the seafood industry is an industry where there's a lot of slave labor. People are just not conscious about that, right? And so we also want cheap electricity, but we don't want cheap coffee. We want expensive coffee and we buy expensive bottled water, but we want to have cheap something else. And there's not, the key is not to go buy expensive. That is not the point. The point is that to be aware of the products we use, really, have people been paid properly, particularly those who are invisible and at the earlier point of the value chain? So here's just some examples about being a consumer. The eighth point I want to make is we are also citizens, which means that we need to advocate for policies that really support the poor and support the environment. So, for example, the U.S. is headed to Paris for this whole climate accord. And so the whole idea is currently the Obama administration do have goals, real goals for sort of what the U.S. would do. He has exercised some of those in different ways, such as the Clean Power Plant Act. We have the 26% to 28% carbon reduction. The key really is we have to be sincere going into the Paris Accord. We also have to put money behind it. And so I just want to say the U.S. committed $3 billion over 4 years for green investments. So as citizens, we have to say this is serious. This needs to happen. There are also policies that relate to adaptation and mitigation. Mitigation is to, as best as possible, transition towards a low carbon scenario. But adaptation is where there are parts of the world where people are already dealing with the consequences. And are there any sort of fund and assistance that help them adapt? And overall, there is more emphasis on mitigation and not a lot of emphasis on adaptation. But those are some of the things as a citizen of this country, one can use a voice. The third part actually is as investors, because some of you may not be the students, but there's endowments, there's retirement funds, which are invested in various type of companies. And so on the bishop, from the bishop's conference, we actually have prohibition against nuclear weapons, against gambling companies, against pornography companies, against tobacco companies. So it's not a new thing to have prohibitions against certain type of businesses. A new movement now actually is looking at the carbon footprint of businesses. Their portfolios now, investment portfolios, which actually set a target for what the carbon emission can be. And so one could actually invest in those things, so invest in clean energy. You've heard of that. There's a lot of conversation about divestment on campus. And I think sometimes the divestment conversation is necessary but not sufficient. The key is not to get rid of all utilities and so on, because we need utility, and utility cannot go from coal burning to renewables tomorrow. Right? So there is a journey, and the question is, what are the sincere steps in that journey of a utility company from sort of where it is today in terms of its carbon emissions towards a cleaner? Is there a journey? Is there a plan? Is there a commitment? Is that accountability towards that? And the second thing is not just divestment, is whatever money you is freed up from the divestment is what do you invest in? Okay, and here I want to show my second video about climate investment funds and what they're doing. And I think it's interesting, particularly for students, as you particularly move into your career, to know of some of these areas and around the world and the type of commitments through investments, which is put towards a low carbon economy. So I just want to show you that.
Go above 2 degrees C, the changes are going to be pretty severe and irreversible.
The impacts of global warming will be felt in a very different way in different parts of the world. And unfortunately, those who are least responsible for carbon emissions will be hit hardest.
Countries like Mozambique have no enough financial resources, have no enough technical capacity to invest in this sector.
The world needs significant, relevant, effective instruments that are helping emerging economies and developing countries contribute to this global effort of tackling climate change. And that's what the climate investment funds are really doing.
If we didn't have the chance to find this loan, I would be doing this maybe not this year, maybe 10 years later when I have enough funds. Today, I found this fund and then I did this job properly. Otherwise, I couldn't have done it.
Forest investment program plays a very strategic role by supporting actions that are needed to prepare for the RED initiative, especially for developing innovative institutional and financial models. In particular, the Forest Investment Program will allow us to test these innovative approaches at the local scale, allowing these to be really accessible to communities and ejidos.
If you need help with finance and technology, if you get these two things right with a good governing policy, we'll definitely make our business a thriving business.
We were confronted by recurring drought these past few years. We suffered a lot. This year, by experimenting with this variety of millet that is resistant to drought and has a short growth cycle, we think that our agricultural problem caused by the rarity of rain will be solved. We ask you to multiply these types of initiatives because they allow farmers to improve production and our capacity for resilience. We can be sure that the current harvest will be better than those of recent years.
Innovation is really putting in place policies and guidelines in relation to how indigenous people should be engaged in these processes. And of course, one concrete result of this is also putting in or allocating dedicated grant mechanisms specific for indigenous peoples and local communities under the Forest Investment Program.
Ukraine is one of the least energy efficient countries in the world. This solar power plant in Porogi can produce enough electricity to power more than 2,100 households. The emissions savings are the equivalent of taking 2,000 cars off the road for you.
Phase one is targeted to produce 400 megawatts. That is the first phase of development. DDC is currently developing at Menengai. The rollout of Menengai Phase 1 will be developed by GDC doing the upstream development, while the private sector will be brought in to do the downstream development, which entails mainly power plant construction development.
We have come to realize that sustainability and affordability can coexist while providing better housing for the population. It's an equation that makes perfect sense, and it is what we are trying to prove, especially at the base of the economic pyramid.
We need mechanisms like the climate investment funds because they are producing results, they are showing the way, they are showing it's possible, that these investments are possible and are sound. And so we are showing that, you know, leadership from developing countries, undeveloped countries who have made these contributions, is possible, and that much more can be done.
So I just want to say this is just one example of many, many green funds nowadays. Another website particularly for students to look at is the Eco Innovation Program, which is supported by the European Union. It's a European Union level initiative. And what it does is actually it, first of all, keep track and give a score to the 28 country members in terms of how green they are and how much they've invested in eco innovation. The second thing is that if you look down the, in the website, there are 40 plus industries, and it showcases all the eco innovations within each industry, in every industry, housing, retail, craft, financial services, and so on and so forth. Every industry, the eco innovations in there. And it also has a grant program which supports startups of these eco-based businesses. And it's very exciting. And I know this is Silicon Valley, you like entrepreneurship, but when you click on these different ideas, it relates to everything. Packaging, printing, everything, you know, 40 some industries is pretty broad. So I just want to give you some sense, because I think as the next generation, you have to think about opportunities, that this whole climate conversation is not just a big scold. It's not just a big scold by the Pope. It's also sort of like turning us around to say, you know, it's a love story. First of all, reclaim that love. And use that love in a way to really sort of honor that creation and take it to a different level, reversing some of these problems. I saw this in this video, reminds me of another statement related to climate, and it's the whole issue of climate justice. And it's a very simple idea. It's just that the people who are very poor, the people who are in these island states, the farmer who is in Central America who cannot get a crop because of the changes in climate, they ask the question, we never enjoy the lifestyle that brought this on. You know, we are dealing with the consequences, but sorry, we don't know that lifestyle of overconsumption. Why do we bear the cost? And that's the whole issue of the climate justice. My 10th point now, actually I'm into my 10th point, is the whole idea. I'm going to use two stories to illustrate my 10th point. I was visiting with two senators. We do a lot of these advocacy visits to go into Congress and say, what is happening? What are you supporting? And so on. I visited with a Republican senator who is very passionate about climate, so that we don't want to just draw a line and say Republicans don't care and so on. This is a Republican senator who really cares a lot about climate change. And this particular senator has actually proposed, you know, been part of several bills. One of those is the cap and trade, you know, putting a price on carbon and restricting the level. If you have performance which is below the amount of carbon you could produce, you could actually sell those, and other people who overproduce could buy carbon credits. Very good idea. I said, where is this bill? And the person said, it's dead. It's so complicated. It has over 2,000 pages of text. There's so much sort of, you know, giving this to this industry, giving that to that industry. And the person said, I can't even follow it. I can't support it because it doesn't look like anything we started with and it's not implementable. All right. Then I asked, you know, the U.S. committed $3 billion over 4 years for climate investments. And we just made our first payment, which is $500 million, which is less than one-fourth of $3 billion. So our first year, we are putting in less than what we committed. I said, what do you think of year two, three, and four? She said, I don't think we could get the money. She said, this is a very big fight. She is the person who actually was the deciding vote. And she said, this is a tough fight. I don't think we could get it. And I looked at her, I said, this is not very encouraging. You know, like, this is not very good. I said, are you giving up? And she said, oh, no, I'm not giving up. And then she said, these are several things that we're doing. So she said, you know, in a bipartisan bill, she with a Democrat, they are now looking at super pollutants. Actually, they're these super pollutants, which are soot, aerosols, and methane gas, which apparently is like 100 times more damaging than carbon. She said, you know, a broad climate bill is hard to pass now. But so we're now changing our energy, and we're now going to focus on very specific things with specific outcomes. And she said, you know, people probably won't fight super pollutants. And then another thing she said is, oh, this is something, Carolyn, that would relate to your work. And she said, and it's about clean stove in Africa. And other developing countries, and because stove now produce a lot of soot, it's like a very high percentage contribution from these stove, and it's very bad for people's lungs. And actually, she said, we could deal with clean cook stove. The technology is already there, it's not expensive, and we could actually deal with this issue and also have some impact. And she said, you know what? Nobody gave us permission to give up. Nobody gave us permission to give up. And I just thought that was so inspiring. There is another senator, and he is a Democrat. For like 117 weeks in a row, he goes every week, he goes on the floor, and he has a little speech on climate. Now, I don't know whether he has any audience, but every week, he makes a statement on climate. And he was so eager to get the Pope's statement. He's not Catholic because now he has more, okay, resources to use. And he really researches it. He notes the evolution of butterflies and this particular underwater creature that is an indicator of sort of the state of climate change. But every week he makes a statement. And I walked away from this, and it's a reminder. Nobody gave us permission to give up, and particularly this generation. I think climate is a hard slog. I have absolutely no delusions about that. But it doesn't mean we therefore cannot work the problems. We just have to not give up and keep on finding the next sort of path to take. And I want to end this with another video. It's only about 3.5 minutes. And it's a voice from the past. Most of the students probably don't know him well, and that's Carl Sagan, which for people of my age, he was just a hero. I want to end with a 3.5 minute statement from Carl Sagan.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager. Every hero and coward. Every creator and destroyer of civilization. Every king and peasant. Every young couple in love. Every mother and father. Hopeful child. Inventor and explorer. Every teacher of morals. Every corrupt politician. Every superstar. Every supreme leader. Every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on the mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they can become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
So thank you very much. By the way, all three videos are available on the internet, and Teresa tells me now I am to take questions. Yes. We need to wait for the microphone.
I just have a question about our country's political philosophy as it relates to the climate change. We've seen a lot of statistics in recent years talking about how above and beyond the U.S. wastes more than almost any other country on the entire planet, and how we really need to take action. At the same time, ours is a country that was founded on the notion of individual rights. And as a result of that, there are a lot of people, some of whom I've met at this university, who don't believe in the common good and actively despise and hate the notion of a common good. So for the climate to change, the U.S. simply has to stop producing and wasting as much. So how do we convince a nation to do this where belief in the common good is not supported?
Yeah, by the way, the U.S., in terms of a cumulative level, I think it's the second largest polluter. China is number one, but per capita basis, we are the highest. All right. So as the Pope talks, actually, in the end, he asked for two things, and that is human dignity, safeguarding the dignity of each person, and I think creation to, but the second one is the common good. I have been told several years ago, I actually read that the common good is actually a dirty word in Washington, D.C. If you want to go far, you don't use that particular term, all right? And I am not a, you know, change maker of to the extent where I could change people's minds so that they would love the term common good. But I just have to say that for each of us, and for a university like this, is to cultivate that sense of common good. And to the extent that we believe in it, all change begins with us, with yourself. And I think that is a certain point is not to give up because others don't believe, is to sort of work on what you do believe. I think that inspiration, adult inspiration, come from looking at another person. So just like I said, after I visited with these two senators, I knew I couldn't give up. I just felt like these people keep on trying and we just have to be innovative. We don't know where the tipping point is, but there will be a tipping point. So I think the key is not to get the mass public, you know, to buy into the common good. Is for those who do, is to act on it. And for an institution like Santa Clara, you know, that notion needs to be widely understood. Right? Anybody else?
Thank you.
Oh, I need a microphone here.
Thank you. Oh, sorry. Okay. Go ahead. Thank you. Very humbling. It's very excellent presentation. But I have to ask, there's a young people here in this audience who are idealistic and go home and see their parents' lives and often will get into fights with their parents because they see them doing selfish things, a lot of the things that you were discussing in terms of your presentation. What message can you give the young people here who have that idealism to keep that mission in terms of trying to do better in terms of the common good and keeping up this consciousness of responsibility to those outside of their own existence?
Actually, I wonder whether a young person would help me answer that question, is how do you engage your parents, particularly when they have a different philosophy? I just have two things to say about that. I don't think that people are selfish or people are dug in just because they're mean. I think that in our society nowadays, there's a lot of fear. There's a lot of insecurity. The days when America feels like a really possible place with opportunities for everyone, I think that sense is lost. And I don't think it's just lost for young people. I think it's lost in some ways for older people. So I think that a lot of behaviors that we've witnessed, I truly believe, is not out of complete sort of lack of humanity. We do see that, but not this type of problem. But there is a lot of fear. And I think the only antidote to fear is love. I think the love of a family, the love of a son for elderly parents, the ability to make a pledge and say, you know, we are in this together as a family, whatever I can do, I would do. So I think it should recognize how much fear grips American politics, actually. And I do believe, I just really do believe that love is the antidote to fear. But the other thing is that I think parents learn from their children. And not in arguments, but when they observe their children really spending less, really sort of recycling. I have sons who go to Goodwill to buy their clothes. And I have to say, it never entered my mind that Goodwill is a place you go buy your clothes. But both of my sons do. And no, I don't go to Goodwill to buy my clothes, but I don't buy a lot of clothes. Period. And so I think a lot of learning from adults is behavior. I think to the extent that children could model that behavior and not to judge too hard. I think that's the other thing too, is that we don't know how to disagree and move on with life. Somehow when we disagree, we just cannot come together anymore. I think the ability to actually be able to sort of hold that disagreement but make progress in other aspects of life. And I think overall, as families, maybe less argument and just more love. Another area that I follow a lot, because I used to be a dean of of a school, and I follow sort of student trends, is the degree of depression in colleges. Every year, UCLA does a study of freshmen. It shows that 10% of students declare themselves severely depressed. 30% are on some type of medication. The major issue on a lot of campuses now is the concern about suicide. Last year, there were 1,100 suicides on campus. And so I think that as a society, the fear and sort of the sense of, do I belong? Do I have a place? You know, who loves me, actually? Who claims me? And a sense that I can't make it on my own. And the question is, why does any of us think that we have to make it on our own? I think those are some of the issues, and long step from sort of like our politics. But I think these are some of the, when we lose the sense of common good, I think that that's when we really sort of dig in. But when it comes to children and parents, perhaps more loving response, let the argument sort of sit and the disagreement sit, but be able to sort of love, be able to model, you know, that behavior. Thank you. Can I give it to this student up here? Okay.
Thank you. So thank you for your intervention. I wanted to tell you, I saw the video of your intervention in the Vatican. Unfortunately, even if I'm from Rome, I couldn't go there in person, it was closed. But I remember that there was a part in which you said that we should do three things. That is, start with consciousness and then evolve going to conduct, okay? And I wanted to ask you, how do you think we should involve, especially new generation, in changing their conduct? Because I always see that to involve people in being proactive towards climate change, the approach is like, oh, look, this fish dying. And then you become sad for 5 minutes and then it's gone. So do you think that's the way to go? Or do you think that we should maybe change the approach in making people change approach? I don't know if it's clear.
Your question is what approaches can you use to get people to be conscious? Because a lot of conversion begins with consciousness. And, you know, I don't study those things enough. I mean, there are people, educators, who do that. But I do believe that, you know, I am a generation where I changed. I was not born into a context where I value the environment. That was, word was not even around, all right? When I was born, we were not environmentally conscious because that was not even an issue. So I think that people are capable of changes of consciousness. I just want to share two things. I think personal experiences are important. So for some people, they would tell me, they went to the Arctic glaciers and they saw sort of the incredible melting of the glaciers. And all of a sudden they say, wow, this is real. All right. And so perhaps, or people who used to grow certain things and they love butterflies and now butterflies don't come, for example. Then they said there is this issue. One young person told me, and he is now working at the Catholic Climate Covenant. He said the way he came into it was that when he was young, he went to India, I think, but into the very high mountain areas and almost into the Himalayas. And he got very sick and the community took care of him and really nursed him back to death, to life. So anyway, so he loved that community. He became a part of the community. But malaria was beginning to happen in that area, and mosquitoes never went to that altitude because the weather was too cold. But that there was enough change that these people now get malaria because they're mosquitoes and they don't have the genetic makeup to defend themselves against malaria. They didn't live in swampy lowlands where malaria is an issue. These people are completely unprepared for malaria. And so it was the presence of mosquitoes for this young person who said, there is an issue here. And I could see that this population has become vulnerable to this particular problem. So I think each person needs the personal experiences. I think it's important as parents to expose yourself and your children to something that you could identify with. The second thing I want to say is that there is a commercial, and I forgot which commercial it was, and I think it was in the 80s. And it says, you cannot conserve something that you don't love, and you cannot love something you don't know. All right. And so if we talk about nature, there is a whole question too, is that, is this a generation where nature is very much part of their sort of social life and activities and so on? So that's the other side, is you cannot conserve what you don't value, what you don't love, and you don't, cannot love something that you don't know. Okay. Okay. Last question.
Carolyn, thank you for so many insights. I loved what you said about the fact that all things are one, all things are connected, that there's one ecosystem. And it struck me that the economic ecosystem is part of that oneness, and you referred to that. In that context, and I know Catholic Relief Services promotes fair trade, and I'm a fair trade ambassador for Catholic Relief Services, so I'm your humble servant. I know, I'm just kidding. What do you see as the connection between the fair trade movement and this crucial movement of climate reform, climate protection?
Yeah, when fair trade began, it was really wasn't a climate-based movement. It was a justice movement. And it was the whole idea that a lot of these artisans and these farmers, they have absolutely no bargaining power. So they have to sell at whatever price that consolidators or wholesalers or whatever buy at. So fair trade is really, first of all, organizing these farmer groups into one big group, because you can work with them. To improve the quality of their product, and a lot of times through certification, so that they could negotiate directly with the Starbucks and the whatever it is, and they don't need to depend on the middleman that squeeze out. So it's to organize them enough to have the leverage to be able to sort of negotiate for the right price so that they could make a living. So that was the beginning of fair trade. And by the way, people asked me, one time I gave a talk on this, and they asked me whether that was communistic. Carolyn, isn't that communism? And I was so stunned by that question. I said, I live in Indiana, and farm co-ops is a way of life. You know, American farmers organize themselves into co-ops so that they could sell and they could store and they could do whatever in a way that increases their leverage. So I think that settled that question, that this is not communistic. This is good old sort of collective organization to be able to have more bargaining leverage. And by the way, it's not enough just to organize. You have to really improve your product to a certain point. Otherwise, you may want to buy fair trade, but you don't want to buy fair trade bad coffee because you're not coming back. By the way, fair trade chocolate is the best kept secret. It is really good. And it's really well priced. It's like $3.50 for a pack when you buy them from 10,000 Village. And the dark chocolate is to die for, actually, or to gain weight for. I mean, better still. So actually, it was not just creating a collective. It's also therefore having the investments to improve their quality, to get their certification, for them to improve their processes and so on. So I would say fair trade, I don't know how many years it began, but at least where I became conscious of it was probably in the 70s. But nowadays, the climate piece becomes very important because the effects of climate change are really borne by 3 billion of the world's poorest people, and 1 billion of them are farmers and fishers. All right. And so in order, if nothing else, for them to continue producing, this whole issue about anticipating the effect of a 2-degree climate change, do we need to change the type of seed variety? Does it have to be drought resistant? How do we deal with irrigation issues? How do we plant shade crops, for example, to shelter, and also to add soil diversity into the soil? And how do we do drip irrigation, for example? So it's now actually changing a lot of the farmer practices so that they could actually continue to produce. So now the climate piece is integrated into the production piece.
Thank you.
All right, oh, we're done.
Yes, thank you very much, Dr. Woo.
Thank you very much.